So all I saw last night was World War III, the demise of the Roman Catholic Church, the rise of the fourth dimensional spiritual power structure headed by Indians, and wondering what to do about it and where to go from there. That's all. Now, this World War III will not be atomic. What I was looking for was to see if this is atomic weapons are being used. They're not. I didn't see that. However, the intensity of it makes you think that it's as if it were atomic weapons, but I did not see atomic weapons being used. So we are literally in the end times. We're in a transition phase right now. The Roman Catholic Church is truly on its final legs. This is the final pope. And actually, the Roman Catholic Church is the continuation of the Egyptian mystery teachings of transubstantiation. You see, there was a whole science of that. What they used to do, the high priests and the pharaohs, etc., priesthood, they had a way to convert the atomic structure of some material. I'm not sure if it was gold or something like that. And then they would eat these wafers of this transubstantiated material that had the higher energy atoms in them. And they thought too that they could replace their bodies, the atoms in their body this way, and make it higher energy. And if you replaced enough of the atoms in your body with this, by eating these wafers, you would attain some sort of immortal awareness, a higher spiritual awareness, etc. So that got carried through into the communion, etc. Remember, Egypt was the world power and the seat of the highest learnings for thousands of years on this planet. And then Rome came along and ultimately triumphed militarily, but the higher esoteric teachings in Egypt kept going on and were folded into what we call now Roman Catholicism, and the idea of salvation through eating a wafer that has been quote-unquote miraculously changed in its fundamental nature, which comes from the Egyptians had this, they had the pyramids, they had various ankhs, they had various ways to somehow concentrate energy in a certain way to change the atomic structure of matter in small amounts. And so that's the basis behind the priest miraculously changing the wafer into the body and blood of Christ, meaning changing the atomic structure of it. So with fourth dimensional religious teachings that I saw that the Indian people are going to be in charge of more is again, a blend of religion and science, how to live a good life, how to live a balanced, harmonious life, that sort of teaching. That's fourth dimensional teaching. And it's all hooked in with the New World Order, the United Nations, and the power structure of elites. That is what they're going to give to the people, and saying this is the new religion is how can you live a happy life? You know, how can you live a happy life in this simulation of time? And everybody will try to, you know, meditate and lead a balanced life, leading a balanced life, a life, and then based on scientifically what is your, you know, your genetics, your DNA, and all these things, that'll be part of a New World religion. Of course, this has nothing to do with salvation whatsoever. This is just the mind, again, telling us lies about how we can be happy. So, I've had numerous dreams of World War III. And it's the first one I thought was going to be just an economic collapse. But now that they've been repeated, that these blow-ups, I would say that I misinterpreted it out of hope that it wasn't World War III, actually. That can happen. You know, the true interpretation of what you're shown it may be so unpalatable that you say, oh, I cannot wrap my mind around that. But unmistakably, this dream last night was this tremendous kaboom and smoke and dust and hot gases, and just rose like a mushroom cloud, but it didn't mushroom as an atomic explosion would. So there are going to be weapons used that are incredibly powerful, but don't have the fallout and the mushroom cloud aspect of atomic weapons. And it is going to be a huge dust up. Very, 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 very bad dust up. It'll make World War I and II look like minor stuff. Because in the first dream I saw this cult, collapse into turmoil was recovered from pretty nicely, and then the second again was stronger, and yet also there's managed to recover, the world recovered and clean up. But the third was just, you know, immeasurably worse, and hard to fathom. So this is what has been prophesized, and we're certainly very close to it. In the dream also, I was frantically telling people to get to safety. We cannot fool around anymore. It is time to vacate the situation, because it's upon us. It's upon us. So we will see what how things continue to unfold. But I know it's a very stressful time right now. Very uneasy time. We're so far into it. And I would say that we're at the point now where third dimensionals are making a stand and saying to the fourth dimensionals, hey, you are slipping in a police state, a surveillance society upon us. You are doing all sorts of things that are contrary to the social contract. And there's so much trouble brewing around that the fourth dimensionals will very, very likely choose this time to institute a crisis and just sweep all objections aside at this point. So it's a dangerous time. It's a dangerous time. The fourth dimensionals don't take, they refuse to lose. They will do whatever it takes. They will not accept any pushback. And whatever crisis they want to, they feel is necessary, they will certainly engineer that and sweep away all objections in a very strong manner. So again, they have targeted the Roman Catholic Church, is standing in their way. They've been working on that for a long time. And the third secret of Fatima, the reason why it was suppressed, was because it showed the destruction of the church. And of course, that's not a good way to win converts to the church. I went to a graduation, high school graduation today, and the day before, I heard that valedictorians need to submit their speeches ahead of time. There can be no religious content in the speech of valedictorians, and the speeches need to be checked to make sure that there are no religious references. And this shows, I don't know how widespread this is, but it seems to be, this is the trend, to get all religion out of schooling. Pretty interesting. How about getting all secularity out of schooling? That would also be interesting. You can get them both out if you want to, but if you want to get something out, get them both out, and get both religion and secularity out, and what you're left with would be then Holy Spirit, true reason, the reasoning of the Holy Spirit that it shows to us. That's a true education, because it's different than the reasoning that we're used to. It's not scientific reasoning. It's not religious reasoning. It's a higher. It's true. It's literally truth, and then truth representing itself through reason and clarity. That would be the true education. So you see these people, young people, getting ready to go on with their lives. And you wonder what is in store for them. Because how could Roman Catholicism possibly end? It's got 1.2 billion converts to it. In fact, a very large number. It's been the power structure, major power structure on this planet for a long time. Numero uno. And of course the fourth dimensionals aim to bring it down. Absolutely. And they've been trying their best. Absolutely trying their best. To demoralize it, to delegitimize it. So just religion in general has been under severe attack. And how to bring it down will be most certainly a global conflict where just any and all means will now be used to implement strict controls and on society, on what we do. And the aim is, again, for fourth dimensionals to bring in their teachings, which basically say to follow what the fourth dimensionals tell us to follow. And to, in other words, to trust in the mind. That's basically it, trust in the mind. Catholicism is like saying that you can change the mind. You know, change the mind, which you cannot, of course. Whereas fourth dimensional teaching is more like saying trust the mind, which you cannot, of course. I mean, not what this idea that we have given mind, you can't trust it at all. What you can trust in is giving mind a different idea to present to us. That is the teaching of the Holy Spirit. So you have different teachings. Third dimensional will say, the mind is crazy, but we can change the mind. We are going to gradually alter the very structure of the mind. Fourth dimensional will say, no, we can learn that we can learn to accept the mind, and we can work with the mind, and we can get the right results from the mind, and we can achieve balance within the mind. And so they're saying, trust the mind. And Holy Spirit teaching says, the mind is our obedient servant, no matter what it seems like. We're in charge of it. We're in charge of the mind. And the only way we can be happy is to give mind another idea. That is to prep for timelessness. So you don't try to change the mind. You don't try to trust what the mind is presenting right now as presentation at all. That's totally, it's nothing but lies. Nothing but lies. Give mind a new idea. The idea of preparing for to step into timelessness. Give mind that new idea. That's the Holy Spirit teaching. So you have this crossroads right now. It's a three-way crossroads, you might say. All right? You have the teaching of the third dimension, which is sort of exemplified by the Egyptian Roman Catholic ancient power structure of trying to transmute the mind, trying to change the mind. You have the fourth dimensional power structure, which includes many other planets and other places in the cosmos, the fourth dimensional teachings, and they've come here and they've taken over the planet. And that says, hey, we can learn to trust the mind and its presentation. We can work with it and be happy with it. And then you have the Holy Spirit saying no to both of those. You can't change the mind. You can't make this presentation the mind is giving us work for us. It's impossible. But we do, we're spirit, we say, mind, here is your new idea to present to us. And then mind, being the obedient servant that it is, will present that to us. So we are at this three-way crossroads. Three-way crossroads. All right? So this is the theme that this video has developed now. We're at a three-way crossroads. And we're looking at the big picture. We're looking at the history of this third dimensional history of this planet, the fourth dimensional history of the cosmos, and the fifth dimensional Holy Spirit teachings of truth, which are truly liberating. And that is the whole kit and caboodle of what's going on here on this planet. This is called the big picture. This is the panoramic picture. Three-way crossroads right now is where we're at, that crossroads. And of course, when we get to a crossroads, we're looking around and say, which way should we go? I'm not sure. Well, certainly, we should have a pretty good idea. Pretty good idea. The third dimensional belief is that we can take refuge in the church, refuge in third dimensional institutions, and this will protect us. That somehow there's a magical power in there. Of course, there isn't. The fourth dimensionals will have the capacity to crush those. They have no respect for whatsoever. So they're not held back by any sort of awe or anything like that. So taking refuge in third dimensional institutions is not a good idea. Fourth dimensional teachings, of course, are nonsense. Pure arrogance, you have to call them, pure arrogance. That says that somehow you can have the simulation of time, as preparation to step into time, which would be really meaning preparation to step into annihilation, and that somehow as we go along this way towards our eventual annihilation, that we can somehow make it all right. You can't possibly make a lie all right. You can't possibly make a lie true. But the fourth dimensionality is a way of saying that we can make lies true. We can make lies true. That we just have to control everything. Monitor everything, regulate everything. All our appliances will be regulated, all our energy use, our car, the black boxes in our cars, everyone's life will be monitored on an ongoing, immediate basis. All the algorithms, it's interesting, the algorithms, Al Gore rhythms, is very interesting names at play in the world. All these algorithms will be controlling our lives. And by this, in doing this, we think we will build a perfect society. The fourth dimensionals want to build a perfect society. And they think by building a perfect society, like a machine, a robotic society, as it were, that everything will be fine. Everything will be great. And this is, of course, the very depths of naivete, you know. And such arrogance that it blinds, the fourth dimensionals are utterly blinded to the utterly silly charade. You know, it's just so ludicrous, you can't hardly even comment on it. But the idea of hey, wait a minute, look what we can do with all this control, the mathematics and electronics, and control, and be able to monitor everything, and just imagine what we can do. Just like John Lennon was a fourth dimensional. Imagine, the song Imagine was really about the fourth dimensionals taking over. Imagine there's no heaven, you know, no hell below us. Everybody living in harmony, meaning everybody living in a controlled drone society where everything is monitored. So, of course, in such a place you have the party insiders who have all the perks and all the, they can get away with whatever they want to get away with. And you have all the carbon credits, the whole thing of just absolutely controlling society. Putting into to an extraordinary extent where everybody is aware of what everybody else is doing as far as, you know, everyone will be, have like data values, and you can check everybody's data value and say, okay, this is what they contribute, this is what they support, this is what their energy usage is, this is what they do. All these ways of reading people through data. Yeah. So, and a lot of people think that's great. Think, oh wow, you know. But it's hellish. It's hellish. So, in the fifth dimension, Holy Spirit truth raises us up into where we have real value. Real property, as it were. Our property is real. It's endless. It has true value. And that is a totally different feeling than the third and fourth dimensions. three-way crossroads right now. We're at a three-way crossroads. The fourth dimensionals are very, very sly. They're real sly dogs, I'll tell you that. They're even difficult to get the entire picture. Therefore, I was sort of hobbling along, and they certainly tried to use me, and unsuccessfully, for the most part, unsuccessfully. Because it was just hard to get the whole thing into focus, the whole three-way crossroads into focus, the totality of this planet, what's going on, the history, the cosmos, everything into one neat, nice, clean package so that you can see the difference between third, fourth, and fifth dimension and see all this thing just in one clear, you know, picture. It was quite difficult. So the fourth dimensionals absolutely tried to get me to do their work for them and help them out and offer me all sorts of inducements to do so. But I knew there was something up that was very fishy, but getting to the bottom of it was very much an ordeal, actually. The fourth dimensionals can be very, very slippery, as they have sort of a sort of, their arrogance is not, you can feel it, but it's easy to think that, oh, they really know what they're talking about or something, when they actually don't. And of course they're so convinced that they are bringing, they're going to alleviate so much suffering on the planet, they're so sure of it, that they don't even question it, that you feel like, well, if you want to help people, you know, here's the way to do it, here's the way. And it's not easy to resist, say the least. So all of these issues are right now on the table. Three-way crossroads. This is a way to look at the world right now. Three-way crossroads. We're at a three-way crossroads. The conflict that is coming is designed to basically crush the third dimensional institutions and basically obliterate any more third dimensionality and to wipe the slate clean of that and institute the fourth dimensional control teachings on this planet. So that means a lot of turmoil. A lot of turmoil. A lot of things being pulled apart. Structures of society, structures of culture, structures of expectation, of belief, of hope. All of that just up in flames. And people will then, basically to survive, will need to do it the fourth dimensional way. You know, the fourth dimensionals will have supplies. They will say, look, if you want to survive, we'll help you, but you need to go all in for what we have, what our teachings are, and what our culture and everything is, and you'll have to submit to that. And so here we are. It's not a happy time to be here, really, in this world, in one regard. And in another way, it's a great time to be leaving the world, as it were, not through succumbing to things, but by some sort of ascension. Hold on one second. So the question, the dream that I was left with is, okay, so I'm not taking refuge in third dimensional institutions. I'm fleeing the fourth dimensional conflict here. Where do I go? So I'm trying to remember, I was outside a church and I was looking out there. I saw some place that seemed to be free of conflict, like a plaza or a fountain there, and something, there was something there for sure. I just wasn't looking at it. I was more looking back at in the church where everybody was desperately trying to take communion, thinking that was going to protect them from the war, from the conflict. So in order to see where safety really is, we have to, at some point, turn from the whole third dimension, fourth dimensional situation. Just look away from it. Just have to look away from it and see what we can see. And that was the part that I had not quite done sufficiently. Stop trying to prop up. Interestingly enough, the third dimensionals also recruited me to try to protect and save the church, their institutions. I was heavily recruited to do that. So both the fourth and the third, heavily recruited me, and many others as well, for their side of the conflict. It's just like any war, it's like recruiting generals. You try to recruit the best generals for your side. That is just standard operating procedure, of course. So if you have the capacity, the will, and clarity and will, like a general, you most definitely are going to be courted as a very valuable asset. And the third dimensionals felt that they can win this struggle if they just have sufficient inspiration. And the fourth dimensionals, again, feel that they can make easy work of the third dimensionals if they just are clever enough and artful enough and use their tactics, which are a little bit different. So I had to reject both ways. I say, no, I'm not going to work for either side. That's why I was always told to be like a Swiss. They say, what are you? You're like a Swiss. What do you mean? Neutral. Neutral. Be neutral in the third and fourth dimensional conflicts. Be neutral in that. And then by being neutral, you can turn away from both of them, from the conflict, and see what is true safety, what is true salvation. So where we're at right now is to see that. I didn't do a good enough job in the dream of paying attention to, I was a little bit too caught up in the turmoil and hubbub of the conflict and what people are doing, and hoping I can save them and help them, and thinking, wow. So it's very stressful, disturbing time right now, actually, because it's time to focus on the road ahead, which means the fifth dimension. And we have to leave the third and fourth dimensionals to their own devices. We will not be a general in this war. We'll not be a general in this war. And so, of course, will not be a hero to the third dimension, and he won't be a great triumpher for the fourth dimensionals. He won't be the one who has the processional march through the column and the great processional arch, marching through there. He won't be the one who helps, be part of the winning team. He won't be part of the winning team. So those are roles that have to be given up. This is part of the difficulty, because in third dimension we are trained to be heroes. If you have the right stuff, you're supposed to be a hero, and you're supposed to fight the valiant fight. And the fourth dimensional, you're trained to be super effective, very intelligently and cleverly effective in minimizing, making it easy. You're supposed to be very inventive and artfully, creatively intelligent to make it easy to undermine the will, the psychology of the third dimension, to undermine their whole psychology and will. That's what you're trained to do. And in that, you become very aware of the whole pattern of the third dimensional functioning and how to undermine it all. So one has to lead it to reject those roles, the roles that were you know, in history, will seem to give you some sort of applause in history. Fourth dimensionals don't care about third dimensional history. So their actions are surprising to us, because most of us third dimensionals, we want to go down in history in a positive light. But the fourth dimensionals know that they'll be writing their own history. And so it doesn't matter. The third dimensionals can absolutely revile somebody here, and they don't care. Fourth dimensional, they don't care, because they'll be writing the history. And they'll just write it the way they want to write it. But they don't care if everybody's against, or many people are against them, or the third dimensionals hate them. They don't care at all. Because they know that they're going to win, and they will write the history, and they will make themselves look like, you know, the best people that ever lived. It doesn't matter what the third dimensionals think about it. So there's this curious disconnect between the fourth dimensionals and the third dimensionals, where the fourth dimensionals just act like they're above it all and don't care what the third dimensionals are thinking, are feeling towards them. Not important, low information people, that kind of thing. It doesn't matter, because they'll be writing the history. That is why. So the third dimensionals are very confused about this. They think, my gosh, don't they realize that they're going to go down in history as just terrible, 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 you know, invaders and just awful? Don't they realize that? And they can't believe it. Why would anybody want that? Again, the fourth dimensionals will be writing the history books. And so all of the third dimensionals will be written down as Neanderthals, as just a dead end, evolutionary dead end, an evolutionary dead end, not even important to really even consider for the most part. So it doesn't matter what you're standing as a third dimensional, you will be lumped into the categorization, the complete stereotype of third dimensionals as just being ignorant, dead end of evolution, and winning the Darwin Prize as stupidity. It doesn't matter. So that's what's going to happen. Of course, the fourth dimensionals will get a surprise too later on with the cosmos. And they will be written out of the history books in a whole different way, through cosmic catastrophes. But in the shorter term here, we have the fourth dimensionals are going to rewrite history and write it the way they want it to sound. But who wants to be part of that? Who wants to vilify the third dimension and all of that kind of stuff? Nah, it's not interesting. So we still are coming up a little short in seeing the remedy. We have to somehow get our attention onto the remedy, onto the fifth dimension, onto the Holy Spirit's remedy for us, and let go of the baggage of this conflict between the third and fourth dimensionals. Let go of the roles that are being held out for us. Get over the fact that you're going to be written out of history. Most certainly you will. That's upsetting to me, because in the past life I was written into history. So it's difficult, you know, to see yourself written out of history. But you know that happens. You know, the history that we read, a lot of stuff has been written out of history. The victors write the history. So, of course, it's vexing to a lot of people. They say, oh my gosh, I worked so hard and did so much in third dimensional, and now suddenly I'm just going to be completely stroke of a pen. It never existed, never did anything. That's a tough one. It's really a tough one. That's something I've struggled with. Because you work hard in third dimension, you work hard to build up a reputation, you work hard to build up a functionality, and to realize that you are, it's all going to be just completely written out, stroke of a pen, a delete button, and it's still on, like as if it never was. That is really a tough one. So, I've always said it's better to be a nobody here, because then that's not a problem. If you've never done anything much, then what do you have to try and protect? Anything. I'm not losing anything. So, I would say there are various factors that keep us from looking at the remedy. And in order to look at the remedy, you have to turn away from the conflict and say, it doesn't matter what happens. It doesn't matter what happens. And so these are the kind of struggles that we have. All of us have certain struggles. And we need to just be aware of them and ask for help in getting past these struggles. Some people don't want to lose their property. They say they've worked hard. They've worked many lifetimes to be capable of generating a successful life here, multiple properties, big bank account, influence, all that stuff. And then they realize they're going to lose it all. They don't want somebody else occupying their property. They want the fourth dimensionals coming in and just taking over their property. Which is, of course, what happens in conflict. We saw that, and we see that in all conflict. You've worked so hard for your estate, the conquerors come in, and you're put on that trash heap of history, and they simply occupy your estate with all the work you've done, and get all the profits and surplus from it, and all the power and prestige and money, etc., from the work that you and your ancestors have done for so long. Just like that, they just come in and take it over. And how difficult would it be for somebody to simply leave their vast estates like that and just leave them, realizing they're going to fall into the hands of the invaders, you know? That's why Jesus said it's harder for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. The rich man asked Jesus, what do I do to enter the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus said, sell everything, disperse your assets, and let go of all your assets. Okay? Remove yourself from all of them and follow me. And the rich man says, I'm a king. You know, I can't do that. How can I do that? So, some of us don't have any assets, like myself. For me, that's no problem whatsoever. But the historical thing is more of a problem for me. So again, everybody has different types of problems. Some people have a history of compassion service, and they don't want to, you know, give that their position up as being some super, you know, charitable, compassionate person. Some have a history of religious efforts, and they have high positions in society. The people look up to them. They don't want to give that up. So everybody has something they don't want to give up. And there are various differences there. Some are scroungers, and they want to pick through the debris of the conflict. We'll give an incredible opportunity to loot, to steal, to scrounge, to pick through an enormous amount of stuff and get bargains. Bargain hunting is a big one. In the upcoming conflict, there will be, you know, opportunity to get stuff free. You name it. And that is a very tempting thing for many people. I've been through that struggle too. Some people can't resist the idea of, like, oh my gosh, there's something there just free. I just can take it. All I have to do is just take it, seize it. I can just take it. There's so much social unrest and people being displaced and all this kind of stuff, and people being vulnerable, and you can literally, you know, just come in and, you know, take the jewelry and take all. Imagine if you just could have a chest full of diamonds and stuff, and, you know, it's yours. You have it. opportunity will be there for those who want that. Cars seizing vehicles and seizing property, seizing everything, all this stuff. Just, you know, just not as a warrior so much, but as just as many people are very clever opportunists. That's a big temptation, very big temptation to remain here. Look at this opportunity. That's a big temptation. I've been tested on that one a lot. And, you know, it's like, here, let me give this to you. It's free. It's free. You just say, no, 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 thanks. Don't want it. So we need to look at these various aspects. What is holding us back? And what are these temptations? Temptations of the world at this time. There are others who long to commit crimes. Crimes against persons, crimes against humanity, crimes against property. Very destructive. There are those who want to be tribal. I want to be like some sort of mini tribal king or potentate or something, of grabbing you know, a harem and grabbing people into their own protection under their protection, and have the power of life and death over these people. That kind of thing. They want to play that game, and there'll be plenty of people playing that game as everybody is desperately scrambling for protection. It's easy for those to arise who will say, look, I'll offer you protection, but you're part of my harem now. You know, you're part of my family under me, and you basically are life and death rest in my hands. So you're gonna act exactly as I tell you to, so to speak. And so you get that too. People are tempted, very much tempted in that. It's just the capacity to control people directly like that. And most of us say, wow, no, who wants trouble like that? Who wants that trouble? No way. So the myriads of temptations here in the world now. So again, some people just love pillaging, destruction, appetite for destruction. There are many people here in the world who are here because they have this tremendous appetite for destruction. They just love it, and the opportunity will be there. Like in the wars of Europe, wars of Reformation and the various wars that the land became lawless for a large part, and you had those who were had money and enough money and power to have bands of warriors together. They band together, and they had the weapons and stuff, and they would ride through the countryside, just wreaking havoc. Pillaging, destroying, burning, and raping—just, you know, through the countries, unimpeded. There was no law. Unimpeded, there was no law. And so, just the idea that you can do whatever you want to do with no law to tell you otherwise, no restraints as far as that's concerned. People have historically have been severely tempted for that. So when you have a situation, a breakdown, you have people being attracted to the lawlessness, those with an appetite for destruction. There's many people here in the world who have that. And you see them in their video games and stuff, and their music, just idling, treading water. They listen to this music, and the videos are just, you know, terrible destruction. Charles, just, you know, the music. I just want to destroy. Come on. They're just treading water, waiting for their time. So all of those things is like looking for opportunity here. Instead of turning away from the world and looking for opportunity in the fifth dimension. So we're all a little bit behind the eight ball and needing to get up to speed better on the fifth dimension. And shaking off the dust of this world and not looking for opportunity here. Even opportunity to help, that's a subtle one. Because what is help? You know, that's a very generic term. And all the sorts of help that people will be yelling for is really these roles that we may not want to play at all. Help. I need help in pillaging. I need help in acquiring, scrounging stuff. I need help in protection. I need help in fighting. I need help in this way and that way. I need help in winning this and winning this battle. Is that, you know, is that the help, or do you want to just, you know, help the fallen and dress their wounds, etc., etc.? Jesus said, let the dead take care of the dead, meaning let the third and fourth dimensionals, let them take care of their wounded and dead. He says, Jesus said, for us, we're going to the higher kingdom of heaven, fifth dimension. And so your job is not to take care of the fallen and wounded of the third and fourth dimensions, the problems, the cleanup. There's another one. The cleanup from the conflict is a big one. And there are legions of young people here in the world now whose very purpose is to clean up after the conflict. The cleanup after the conflict. That'll be a huge job, because again, it's the crushing of the third dimension and a complete restructuring society and basis of culture, and so many cleanup jobs will be available. Massive cleanup jobs. And that many people are here with their purpose is to clean up after the conflict, provided that they survive it. It's called healing Mother Earth. Healing Mother Earth is, you know, many are here for that. What they don't realize, maybe, or maybe they do, is that they will be enfolded into the fourth dimensional paradigm. And maybe they're feeling that they don't see that. They think, oh no, we're just here to heal the earth. The fourth dimensionals they'll feel the bite. They will feel the bite. So again, let the dead bury the dead, and let those who see the simulation of time. Whoa. Wow. That there's a real-time event. Something is not ready to come down. So something like that. Yeah. Well, no one was hurt. It wasn't hurt, and it was actually a nice, soft, friendly landing there. Nice, friendly landing. Interesting. The land of palms, which is may signify the fifth dimension. The land of palms signifies an oasis in a desert, okay, where everything is lush and green and beautiful. The land of palms. To me, that signifies the fifth dimension. And so that suddenly that palm tree came down and felt wonderful, felt soft. Didn't hurt me or anything. It was a little startling there. A little startling, but it was great. Wow. There's something about a palm tree that signifies oneness. It's just one trunk. There's no complexity of branching. Simplicity. I always love the palm tree. Simplicity, oneness, simplicity, clarity. That's the palm tree. So, as I have said, I expect around June 30th, for there some relief to arrive, and it may be the fifth dimensional presence will touch down here in some way. It will start touching us, like that palm tree just touched me, and it might just be, wow, a little bit sudden for us. But I can tell you that was unexpected. I didn't see it coming, but it was. I immediately realized what it was. And so my pulse, everything is smooth. There was no spike in my heart rate or my fear or anything like that. It just a sort of a little surprise. But the feeling was nice. So it was surprise, but oh, what's this nice feeling? Oh, it's the palm tree. Oh, okay. I'm okay. There's no scratches or anything. Then softly put it back up. So it was actually a pleasant experience, even though it was a surprise. It was a surprise in some way. So I expect that to be what the fifth dimensional experience will be for us. is a surprise, but a very pleasant surprise. Very pleasant surprise. My glasses weren't hurt. Nothing was hurt. My shirt, it's okay. Everything's okay. Everything's okay. Wow. Never fails. Something happens here during the taping. So, what is today? Today is like the 8th. Is it the 8th already? Yeah. So that would just be 22 days away. It could be only 22 days away. Or maybe at this point 21 days away. Let's say 3 weeks away. We could literally get the help that we have been hoping for. That helps us get our attention onto the fifth dimension, away from the third and the fourth. It's kind of difficult to get your attention completely off the third and the fourth when you don't have the fifth, you can't feel it. But we certainly can examine our attachments to the third and fourth, so we're aware of them, and we kind of feel like, you know what, that's not very valuable at all. I don't value this, I don't value that, I don't value that. So what we do is we examine our valuing of the world, a valuing of these roles. Especially important to examine your valuing of the roles that will arise when this conflict gets underway here, because different opportunities will arise, and you have to say, is that really valuable? Is it really valuable? Don't be afraid to look at some role and say, that will be available, a very unusual role that normally isn't available, and is that really compelling and valuable for me? Do I really want to amass enormous storehouses of loot, you know, diamonds? If I just have diamonds, just everywhere, is that really what I want? That's the role I want? That's how I see my identity, is engaged with that? So, we have 3 weeks to continue on with this, and I would say we're very close to the fifth dimension making its presence felt here. Very close. So somehow we just have to keep our nerves together, which is actually very difficult this time. I'd say we can do it. We can do it. 3 weeks is doable. 3 weeks is doable, absolutely. All right. Three-way crossroads, 3 weeks. Very doable. That's it for this one.